So a little bit about Fanatics. As Cara mentioned, we are the global leader in licensed sports merchandise. We're a complex business operating across numerous countries around the world, which has brought a huge amount of challenges during COVID, but also some benefits, which I'll touch upon during the presentation. If we look at Fanatics at a glance, our global turnover last year was over $2.5 billion. And here in Manchester, at our head office, we're responsible for all of the operations outside of North America, which meant at the start of the year, we have closed over five different offices and moved 1,500 employees to remote working over the course of Q1. Looking at our partners, this is the plug I'll do, by the way, but we have two of our own websites, which is fanatics.co.uk and kitbag.com. But as well as our own websites, we work with over 300 partners worldwide. Hopefully you will spot some of your favourite teams and sports here. I'm very pleased to say that I don't have any sporting allegiance, so I'm entirely neutral, which is great for my role to be completely unbiased at times like this. Move to the next slide, please. In simple terms, our business is made up of three core areas, which is e-commerce, retail and events, and wholesale and product. And I'm going to talk today around each of those key areas and how they've all been impacted as a result of the global pandemic. So firstly, let's turn to retail and events, which has been by far our most damaged part of the business. 2020 was going to be a really big year for sports and also for Fanatics. As well as having to close our retail stores due to lockdowns in our stores here in the UK and in Spain, we were also due to be the primary retailer at some key sporting events, particularly the Euros 2020. So it's been really disappointing to see those events being cancelled or postponed into next year. That's brought a significant amount of challenges. Obviously, liquidity management as the tills stopped ringing. We also had some stock which had already been produced for some of these events, which had to be paid for. So a lot of focus on liquidity here. Also the challenge of furloughing. It's been hugely challenging in the world of sport. You will have heard it in the press. A lot of pressure on football clubs in particular of how they approach furloughing. So we've had to strike that very difficult balance of making sure that we look after our own business needs, as well as making sure that we support our partners and the branding image that is linked to sport at the moment, and deal with a huge amount of uncertainty. And that's linked to that business planning place that Karen mentioned. When will sport resume, and when will it resume with fans? And we've spent a huge amount of time, and we'll continue to do so, looking at what the outlook means, depending on how that is staggered through the course of the rest of this year. We have a couple of successes. I wanted to call on one big one, which is we've had confirmation from UEFA that they are going to retain the Euro 2020 branding into the event next year, which means that stock that we've already got produced, we can sell some of it through our e-commerce channels this year, but the rest of it we can put into storage and reuse for next year, which was a huge relief for us as a business. If I now turn to wholesale and product, another big year for this part of the business as well. Excuse me. We are undertaking the manufacture of NFL and MLB jerseys globally on behalf of Nike, which means we had a huge amount of product into the market for the first time. And what we saw in Q1 and into April was a significant amount of retailers cancelling and postponing those orders. We have retailers who have already had their stock. Some of them are unable to pay and not able to provide the cash for that, as well as on the flip side, factories getting nervous and demanding payment for upfront too before they will release any further orders or start working on any more orders. Anybody who works in wholesale or apparel will know that actually in this business you work 12 to 18 months in advance. So we are due to launch this week our spring summer 2021 launches, which would normally be a huge event where we would invite our customers across the world to look at our product. We've now had to switch that to remote, which is happening during the course of this week and next. And obviously very difficult when our customers can't physically touch the product that we're launching into the market. So that's been a difficult challenge for the team as well. And to top it all off, we launched a new wholesale system on the 1st of March. And anybody in the world of finance know that launching a system and then having to work remotely within a matter of days was particularly stressful. So in terms of the challenges, liquidity management, again, as I've touched on, another of our income streams really just dried up at the start of this year. and also thinking about what is the retail outlook going to be for the rest of this year and also into 2021, as we know that a lot of retailers will have an awful lot of stock left and will have to clear. So what will their buys look like as we fast forward into next year? And how will we work with our factories on our minimum order quantities to make sure that we continue to manage the business as best we can? But some positives, we got it through month end, that first month end on a new system. It's all going well. It's a cloud-based system, and we had great support from the tech team here and at our partner to do that. Also, some more positives. As I mentioned, we're global and we operate in numerous different countries. One of the key benefits of that is that we were still able to fulfill orders into countries such as Germany, Japan and Australia, where the lockdown restrictions haven't been as severe. And we've now also been back in contact with our customers in France, Spain and Italy, as they start to see some of the restrictions received. So that's one of the key benefits that we've seen. It hasn't completely dried up as if we were just in one territory. We've also launched, our US parent has launched some face coverings as well, which is going extremely well in the US. They're selling over 100 a minute, and we're looking to bring that internationally as well, so that you can have a face covering with the team or sport of your choice. And that's something that has changed over the coming weeks. I'm sure you've seen in terms of the advice around face coverings. And I must stress, face coverings, not masks, so they're not for surgical use. If I now turn on to e-commerce, this has been by far our success area. Initially, we saw a big drop. So that's next slide, please. Thank you. Initially, we saw a significant drop in the back half of March for the demand. We dropped to 35% below our previous year's performance. But we had a great recovery in April, which is hugely beneficial to us. That income stream has continued. We've had to be very promotional in terms of driving that demand, much more promotional than we'd ordinarily be. However, for us, this is the football season where we get into the end of one season before new kits launch for the next season. So as a result of that, it's not been too harmful. We've just had to be a bit more aggressive on promotionals than we ordinarily have done. The main challenge for our e-commerce business has been keeping our employees safe in our fulfillment centres and our contact centres in order to be able to satisfy the demands of the fans. And our operations team have been absolutely fantastic at this. They've implemented loads of different initiatives to make sure that we can maintain social distancing and keep our employees safe. They've reorganised the flow of the fulfillment centre so that there is now only a one-way system right the way through. We've now segregated ways in and out of the building. And we've also operated shorter shift patterns with fewer members of staff to, again, ease those the restrictions. But that also has meant that our biggest challenge is actually looking forward to what are the capacity constraints that we will face if social distancing measures continue, particularly into those peak trading months for November and December. So we spent an awful lot of time looking at what that could mean for us in the second half of the year. But keeping on the successes of this slide, we are really proud of the amount of work that we've done from a health and safety perspective to look after our employees and keeping our staff at work safe. We have therefore been able to maintain an income stream and cash coming through from customers on a daily basis. So slightly less pressure from a liquidity perspective on this part of the business. We've also seen great partner support as we've been able to share the work that we have done in our fulfillment centres. Our partners have been really supportive and very grateful that we've gone above and beyond the government restrictions to keep the employees safe, because obviously they're also very protective of their brand and need to make sure that when they work with partners like us, there isn't anything that we would be doing that could be putting their brand at harm. So we've had great support and great feedback. And also that we have been able to provide them an income stream when things are looking very tough for them as well, which we hope will lead to a lot more new business opportunities as our sporting partners recognise the need to focus on their core activities of sport due to the additional pressures. They may look at the non-core parts of sport, such as e-commerce, such as their retail stores and their product and licensing, and look at how they could move those to a third party to share some of that burden. So if I move to the final slide in summary, what has that meant for the finance team in particular? I think it's fair to say that 75% of my time has been focused on managing liquidity. I've mentioned two of our income streams have effectively dried up. This hasn't been anything weird and wonderful. It's been just very, very hands-on, managing cash on a day-to-day basis. Also doing our best at keeping up with proactive communication with our suppliers and our partners. Scenario planning has been by far our most other significant part of our time. We've done six formal scenarios, two very worst case scenarios, purely for liquidity purposes. But we've now got a base case, which we're working to for the rest of this year. And one of the challenges that we've had within finance is how much do you involve the rest of the business when you're doing these budgets and these plans? We took the view to, for the first part, is to keep this as desktop finance only reviews up until last week, where we felt now was the time to bring the business back in and look a little bit further ahead and get a joint base case that we all feel comfortable with. And that's really as the rest of the operating functions started to get a little bit of a balance in terms of the future. I've mentioned remote working, a month end, a new system implementation, and we've finished one audit and about to start another. Has been phenomenal. I'm really proud of the team for getting through it. And I wanted to end on a positive note to talk about how I'm really pleased with the amount of business recognition that the back office functions have really received as a result of COVID. Finance, operations, tech and HR have really gone above and beyond to make sure that we keep the lights on as a business. And I think it's great for the morale of the finance team when things are really tough to feel that the rest of the business are cheering us along and supporting us.